Well, Lord Jesus, what a delight it is to meet with you and with these friends this morning. We acknowledge your presence in our midst and for your wonderful kindness in having watched over us while we slept. And we do pause now to ask you to guide us in our study this morning. Thank you for our brother Andy and his preparation, and ask, Lord, that you would give him unusual clarity to impart what you've given him to say. And then, Lord, would you be pleased to illumine our understanding to what your word says and means, and incline our wills to obey. At the same time, Lord, we recognize that there's lots of dramas going on around us, and think of Gina's mother's homegoing, and pray, God, that you might help her in her grief, even as now her dad's quite ill, and ask, Lord, that you might bring friends alongside her to help console her, and that your spirit and your word might console her as well. Lord, I pray that Holly might bear with the pain and the recovery she's under. And Lord, I do especially want to thank you too for our new friend David joining us this morning, and pray your blessings on him and his work and in his ministry, and ask God that we might find warm fellowship together this morning. Lord, we're so grateful for your goodness and ask that you would direct our time. For we pray this in Jesus' name and for his glory alone. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Thank you, John. Well, good morning, everybody. Hey, it's the, as we say, the Clay Terrace Bible Study. We're in the book of Revelation, just zipping right along. we're in chapter 19 today, and we'll be reading that in just a second. Just wanted everybody to feel welcome, whether you live directly in the Clay Terrace neighborhood or you zoom in from wherever. You know, we're just bringing the word of God to the table and trying to decipher his communication to us. And from a pretty diverse standpoint, we have different pastors in the room. Pastor Andy Hunt will be our lead teacher, as is normal. Andy's with New Life Community Church in Indianapolis, which is at the corner of 86th and Ditch. And he presents one point of view with Revelation, and we have some others in the room that may represent other points. And again, together we try to see how it is. You say, Lord, that you're going to bless us for studying this book. So that's what we're here for. We're here to study, to learn, to know God better and his purposes in the world and in our neighborhoods. So anyway, welcome everybody. Anybody could join us on a Friday morning at 8 a.m. Eastern. Details are at clayterrace.org. That's clayterrace.org. So that said, let's start reading through Revelation 19. And I think, Jim Wright, you said you'd lead us off this morning. So two or three verses, whatever works.
Revelation 19, after this, I heard something like a loud voice of a vast multitude in heaven saying, Hallelujah, salvation, glory, and power belong to our God, because his judgments are true and righteous, because he has judged a notorious prostitute who corrupted the whole earth with her sexual immorality, and he has avenged the blood of his servants that was on her hands.
Once more, they cried out, Hallelujah, the smoke from her goes up forever and ever. And the 24 elders and the four living creatures fell down and worshiped God who was seated on the throne, saying, Amen, Hallelujah. And from the throne came a voice saying, Praise our God, all you his servants, you who fear him, small and great.
Anthony, you want to pick it up at, where do we say, verse 6?
Yes.
Then I heard again what sounded like the shout of a vast crowd, or the roar of a mighty ocean's waves, or the crash of loud thunder. Praise the Lord, for the Lord our God, the Almighty reigns. Let us be glad and rejoice, and let us give honor to him. For the time has come for the wedding feast of the Lamb, and his bride has prepared herself. She has been given the finest of pure white linen to wear, for the fine linen represents the good deeds of God's holy people.
David, you want to do verse 9?
Then the angel said to me, write this, blessed are those who are invited to the wedding supper of the Lamb. And he added, these are the true words of God. At this I fell at his feet to worship him, but he said to me, don't do that. I am a fellow servant with you and with your brothers and sisters who hold the testimony of Jesus. Worship God, for it is the spirit of prophecy who bears testimony to Jesus.
I saw heaven standing open, and there before me was a white horse whose rider is called Faithful and True. With justice he judges and wages war. His eyes are like blazing fire, and on his head are many crowns. He has a name written on him that no one knows but he himself.
He is dressed in a robe dipped in blood, and his name is the Word of God. The armies of heaven were following him, riding on white horses and dressed in fine linen, white and clean. Coming out of his mouth is a sharp sword with which to strike down the nations. He will rule them with an iron scepter. He treads the winepress of the fury of the wrath of God Almighty. On his robe and on his thigh, he has this name written, King of Kings and Lord of Lords.
Holly, can you read 17? Take yourself off mute.
She doesn't want to, Neil.
Okay, got it. Got it. Let me pick it up, and then Bob, you can read after me if you're there. Okay, verse 17. And I saw the angel, or an angel standing in the sun, who cried in a loud voice to all the birds flying in midair, come gather together for the great supper of God, so that you may eat the flesh of kings, generals, and the mighty, of horses and their riders, and the flesh of all people, free and slave, great and small.
And I saw the beast and the kings of the earth with the armies gathered to make war against him who was sitting on the horse and against his army. And the beast was captured, and with it the false prophet who was in the presence, who is in his presence, had done the signs by which he deceived those who had received the mark of the beast and those who worshipped his image. These two were thrown alive into the lake of fire that burns with sulfur.
And the rest were slain by the sword that came from the mouth of him who was sitting on the horse, and all the birds were gorged with their flesh. We're going to break down this particular chapter into two sections. Today, we're going to try to deal with just verses 1 through 10, and then next week, verses 11 through the end of the chapter. As you can tell by now, as we get closer and closer to the end of the book of Revelation, John begins to reveal more and more to us. And although Revelation opens up with John focusing upon the persecuted church and their struggle with the Roman Empire, and things that John continues to say must soon take place, now we find ourselves at almost at the end of his vision, and John kind of fast forwards us to the end of time. This means that the Roman Empire and its emperors, they serve as a symbolic picture of all the empires which will rise up throughout the course of this present evil age and will participate in persecuting the church of Jesus Christ. And beginning with the final two bold judgments that we pick up in Revelation 16, you see John here focusing more intently on all the events associated to the end of the age in all the chapters that follow. So as we are continuing this series, we're going to turn our attention again this morning to Revelation 19 and John's account of the wedding of the Lamb. Now, remember, while the harlot is still committing spiritual adultery with the nations, the bride of Christ is preparing herself for her groom. Therefore, the bride of Christ stands in this stark contrast between the harlot, which is a satanic depiction of those who want to destruct the people of God. Now, everything starts from Revelation 16, verse 17, all the way till 18:24, which brings us to where we are now. And as you recall, in chapter 16, John witnesses this angel as he pours out this seventh bowl of God's wrath, which is the final great act of the three great cycles of judgment that we see clearly depicted in the book of Revelation. This seventh bowl of judgment is going to cause this great earthquake, which is going to split the city of man. This is Babylon, the great city of Babylon, into three pieces. And we see this symbolism that John informs us that this particular city sits upon seven hills and serves as a headquarters for the great kings who will arise within it. I think the key to understanding John's symbolic language here is viewed clearly from the Old Testament and from the perspective of the coming of Jesus Christ. You got to take that, set it on the backdrop of the historical content that you recognize that John is writing to a first century church that's dominated by the military and economic might of Rome. There's a connection here between the ancient city of Babylon and the city of Rome. And it tells us John recognizes that his readers would understand the persecution that they're facing. And then throughout the Old Testament, the city of Babylon is depicted as the heart of the pagan empire. So when we look at Revelation chapters 17 and 18, we recognize that John introduces us to the great prostitute, the harlot. He describes the corrupting influences of the city, the great city, Babylon the Great, in the terms that she is a seductress that entices the kings of the nations into committing spiritual adultery with her, which is idolatry. So John has already told us that the harlot has seduced many Christians. He's drawn these Christians away from the bridegroom, which is Jesus Christ, and using those three things that we talked about in the last couple of lessons, her superficial beauty, her great wealth, and her military power. All of these things are nothing but satanic deceptions that will soon fade in order. That harlot John told us about holds that golden cup in her hand that is filled with abominable things. And we recognize that she's the same one who's riding on the scarlet beast, a symbol of her unholy alliance with the beast. And then we see that she is also, because of her persecution of the church, she's drunk on the blood of the saints. Revelation 17:15 tells us that John, he says she seduces the people, the multitudes, the nations, all the languages. And then we move into 18, and then John tells us that heaven itself resounds with praise because God's judgment is just and he will repay this woman in such a way that her punishments will fit her crimes. So we recognize here that the point of this vision is that John hears a voice from heaven that warns God's people one last time that this destruction is imminent and that they need to flee the great city before it's too late. They need to flee the arms of the harlot. We saw that last week in 18:4-19. Then we start to see that the great city is what? It's consumed by flames. The kings of the earth, all of them weep and they mourn at their loss. The merchants weep and mourn because of their loss. The sailors weep and mourn because of their loss. Seeing the great destruction of Babylon, seeing the flames that have consumed her, and they're terrified. Now there are no longer any sounds of laughter in the city, no music in the city, no commerce in the streets. Everything, we see nothing but retribution, because now this city, their streets run with the blood of prophets and the saints. But now as we come into Revelation 19, and we see John giving us a vision of the bride of Jesus Christ, and we see the destruction of the great city coming to an end. And look at the intersection here. The destruction of the great city of Babylon is an introduction to the marriage supper of the Lamb. So you go from those heavenly celebrations and in 18, and it continues in 19, and we open up here. Look at verse 1, look at the fact that we continue to hear this word, hallelujah, at least for the first 6 verses. And it includes these, how this praise is coming from the angels, the praise is coming from the saints, it is coming from all those who have passed during redemptive history. It's coming from those who now feel that their blood has been vindicated by the great God. Now, look at verses 1-3 of chapter 19. Then I heard what seemed to be the voice of a great multitude, like the roar of many waters and like the sound of many peals of thunder, crying out, hallelujah, for the Lord our God, the Almighty reigns. After this, what seemed to be a loud voice of a great multitude of heaven crying out, hallelujah, salvation and glory and power belong to our God, for his judgments are true and just, for he has judged the great prostitute who corrupted the earth with her immorality and has avenged on her blood, avenged her on the blood of his servants. Once more they cried out, hallelujah, the smoke goes up from her forever. So we see here, this really, when you think about it, it makes us think about what we dealt with last week in Revelation 18 and 20. Look what it says. Rejoice over her, O heaven, and you saints, and the apostles and prophets, for God has given judgment for you against her. So here we see the people of God being vindicated as they were promised, the very host of heaven responding here, hallelujah, salvation and glory and power belongs to our God, for true are his and just are his judgments. God is now avenging the blood of all of those who have suffered for righteousness' sake because of the hands of the harlot. I mean, we see this depicted in Revelation 7 and 9 when he says that a great multitude, so large that no one could count it, which meant the number of the elect is not small, and they come from every nation, every tribe, every people, every language, which means that God's elect comes from among all the nations. All of them have come through the great tribulation, which is the entire period between the first advent of Christ and the second coming of Jesus Christ. Now, these are saints that have either died because they trusted in Jesus Christ, or they were put to death as martyrs for their confession that Jesus Christ is Lord and Caesar is not Lord, and they have refused to worship the beast or his image. Now you see a great tie-in here with this celebration that goes back to Revelation 6 and 10. Remember when they said, they remember those martyrs, those saints that were under the altar of God? Remember what they cried out in a loud voice? How long, sovereign Lord, holy and true, until you judge the inhabitants of the earth and avenge our blood? Now we see how long. This is the end. This is where God avenges their blood. Although they have suffered greatly on earth, the time has come now to celebrate. God is judging the earth and avenging them. Therefore, we see them cry out, hallelujah, hallelujah, for the time has come. They see Babylon going up in smoke, and it produces shouts of hallelujah for the multitude of saints in heaven. Look at the verse 4, because you're going to see somebody else join in here in the celebration. Verse 4 of chapter 19. And the 24 elders and the 4 living creatures fell down and worshiped God, who was seated on the throne, saying, amen, hallelujah. So we see here, really, I think you see an echo here. You have to go back to Psalm 106:48, where it says, praise be to the Lord, the God of Israel, from everlasting to everlasting. Let all the people say, amen, praise the Lord. I think we see in this psalm, it's recounting Israel as it is praising Jehovah for delivering them from their enemies who oppressed them. And now we see in the case of the destruction of Babylon, the elders and the 4 living creatures, they shout hallelujah along with those redeemed saints, that now God is ratifying his judgment on those who have oppressed them. But immediately, after verse 4, you hear another voice in verse 5. Look at verse 5 for a minute. And from the throne came a voice saying, praise our God, all you his servants, you who fear him, small and great. Not only is the destruction a cause for celebration, the destruction of Babylon really puts us in the place where all things are coming to an end. All things are consummated. And this brings on the wedding supper. This brings on the bride. Look at verses 6 and 7. Then I heard what seemed to be the voice of a great multitude, like the roar of many waters, and like the sound of the mighty peals of thunder, crying out, hallelujah, for the Lord our God, the Lord Almighty reigns. Let us rejoice and exult and give him glory, for the marriage of the Lamb has come and his bride has made herself ready. You see, it intensifies us here with the voices of praise, which I think is indicative of 2 major developments that's happening here in this passage. Now, the first development is somewhat obscure. When you read in your Bibles, your different translations, it says, the Lord God Almighty reigns. And then John hears this great multitude shouting hallelujah with great intensity. But, you know, really, it should say the Lord God Almighty has begun to reign. This is called an ingressive aorist, which is when it's not a present verb tense, but it happens when a verb or verbs denote the state of a continual action and really expresses the beginning of an action or the interest of that action, or the interest of the state into that action. The point here is that God has begun to reign over all of Babylon because Babylon has been destroyed. Now, it's going to seem like I'm talking out of both sides of my mouth here, but really I'm not. this doesn't mean that God hasn't ruled over everything prior to this moment. Of course he has. But until this moment, God has ruled according to his long-suffering mercies. He's allowed evil to run its course. He's allowed the dragon, the beast, the false prophets, and the harlot to persecute his people. But now, because God's wrath is complete, that is no longer happening. He rules completely here. And John sees that this time God destroys this godless harlot and takes away all of her her privileges in persecuting the church. This is the final phase. You know, we go back to, I think it's Revelation 11 and 15, after we saw that seventh trumpet, and now we see the glorious reality. It said the seventh angel sounded his trumpet, and there were loud voices in heaven which said, the kingdom of the world has become the kingdom of our Lord and of Christ, and he will reign forever and ever. So the kingdom now has come completely, as it's been recorded in all of the gospels. It's being consummated here. Remember, your marriage is not a marriage until you consummate it, right? In several states, you still can have your marriage annulled if you are not able to consummate it. Look at verse 7 here. Let us rejoice and exult and give him glory, for the marriage of the Lamb has come and the bride has made herself ready. So here we see the second development, that the Lord God Almighty has begun to reign. This prompts an even greater magnitude of celebration. The Lamb has come, the bride has made herself ready. Revelation 19 and 8 speaks of her clothing. It was granted to her to clothe herself with fine linen, bright and pure. For the fine linen is the righteous deeds of the saints. Not only has a bride made herself ready, but she's clothed with bright linen, bright and clean, is given to her to wear. And I think it's important that the bride herself, because of her righteousness, of righteous acts, not her righteousness, but her righteous acts, these righteous acts are depicted as being like fine linen. But a groom before the wedding gives her wedding garments to wear. And many people sometimes will take this and go the wrong direction and think that John is teaching a doctrine of salvation by works, but I totally disagree with that. I think he shows us at seven times or more in Revelation by the testimony of Jesus Christ as he refers to God's people bearing witness to the gospel of Jesus Christ in both word and deed throughout the second and the first and the second coming of Christ, that Christ's bride prepares herself for her marriage to the Lamb by doing what? By testifying to an unbelieving world of the truth of the gospel and then matching her profession with good deeds. She's not only talking the talk, but she's walking the walk, that she might speak to others about the beauty of the sanctification that's been given her. If you look at Ephesians 2, 8 through 10, for it is by grace that you have been saved through faith. And this is not from yourselves. It is the gift of God, not by works, so that no one can boast. For we are, and this is the important part, this is 10, for we are God's workmanship, created in Christ Jesus to do good works, which God has prepared in advance for us to do. You know, so many times you will see Christians say, well, you know, I just can't do that. How do I do the good works of God? Well, you know, that's really nothing but a cop-out, because Scripture tells us clearly that it is God himself. We are his workmanship. We have been created in Christ Jesus to do good works beforehand. All we need to do is surrender to the direction of the Holy Spirit, surrender into to our own tendencies to do sinful things, and allow righteousness to work through our members, just like we're allowed sinful things to work through our members when we were without Christ in this world. We're saved by grace through faith and not by works. And it's Christ who has prepared us. God has prepared us to do his good works in everything, where faith and works come together. Works is evidence of the faith that we proclaim. No difference than we see with Abraham. And, you know, Abraham was called the father of righteousness, that because of his faith, it was accredited to him as righteousness. But then we see in chapter 22, he shows his righteousness when he's able to take his son to that mountain to slay him, because God has asked him to do that. So now we see with great confidence, the bride prepares herself for the wedding through the good works that God has called and equipped her to do. Last week, we saw a clarion call from John, when John called his people, "Come out of her, my people, so that you may not share in her sins, so that you will not receive any of her plagues." He was saying, get away from this abominable city, because otherwise you will share in her sins and you will receive her retribution. We've seen these same Christians who resist the world, resist the persecution they were facing, resist the hands and the rules of the state. They rejected the money, the power, the beauty of the harlot, and they receive a white robe. This white robe is an outward sign, not only of the bride's faithfulness to the bridegroom, but this is also her wedding present from Christ. I think we see this clearly in chapters 61 and 62 of Isaiah, when he speaks about the garments of righteousness. But I want to go back for a moment to Isaiah 61 and 10 and see what the prophet declares here. Isaiah 61 and 10. "I delight greatly in the Lord. My soul rejoices in God, for he has clothed me with garments of salvation and arrayed me in a robe of righteousness, as a bridegroom adorns his head like a priest, and as a bride adorns herself with her jewels." Clearly here, the point is to point out the deity of Christ throughout the Old Testament, that Jehovah is saying to Israel, "I am your husband." In Hosea 2:20, again, Jehovah declares to Israel, I will betroth you in faithfulness, and you will acknowledge the Lord." Now Christ assumes the role of Israel's husband, which shows his deity and his divine authority and prerogatives. The righteousness that's spoken to us by the prophet Isaiah points ahead to a time when God will vindicate himself, when he will declare his people to be righteous because of the justification that he's given them, and then he will take them from justification to sanctification. All of this points forward to the messianic age and the coming of Jesus Christ, who will provide his people with perfect righteousness and transform justified sinners into radiant, spotless church members. Look at Ephesians 5:25 for just a moment. Ephesians 5:25. "Husbands, love your wives, just as Christ loved the church and gave himself up for her to make her holy, cleansing her by the washing with water through the word, and to present her to himself as a radiant church without stain or wrinkle or any other blemish, but holy and blameless. I think this is exactly what you're seeing in Revelation 19 from the perspective of this prophecy, that it is God who gives the garments of righteousness to his bride. It is God who helps prepare her to wear them. It is God who vindicates his people for their faithfulness to Christ. It is God who gives them righteous ways in dealing with unrighteous things. The bride is being prepared for the wedding to his son, and all of God's enemies are now being destroyed. All of his judgments have been demonstrated perfectly. That's why I keep saying that all his judgments are true and all his judgments are just. So God deals finally with his enemies and his plan of salvation. We see here that the wedding is now in hand. Look at verse 9 of verse 19 or chapter 19. Verse 9 of chapter 19. And the angel said to me, write this. Blessed are those who are invited to the marriage supper of the Lamb. And he said to me, these are the true words of God. We come in to a type of benediction here when he talks about blessed are these who are invited to the marriage supper. I think it gives us echoes of Isaiah, probably Isaiah 25, 6 through 9. Go back and look at that. It says, on this mountain, the Lord Almighty will prepare a feast of rich food for all peoples, a banquet of aged wine, the best of meats and the finest of wines. On this mountain, he will destroy the shroud that enfolds all people, the sheet that covers all nations. He will swallow up death forever. The sovereign Lord will wipe away the tears from all the faces. He will remove disgrace from his people, from all the earth. The Lord has spoken. In that day, they will say, surely this is our God. We trusted in him and he saved us. This is the Lord. We trusted in him. Let us rejoice and be glad in his salvation. So here, what is Isaiah doing? He's referring to the heavenly Mount Zion, the mountain of gathering here, where Jesus stands alone with his people. The feast in which Isaiah is referring to, we see it in the New Testament as a great marriage supper of the Lamb. And I think you see it clearly in Matthew 22, 1 through 14, and then again in Luke chapter 14, 15 through 22. And I'm gonna just summarize the two of them together here. Jesus tells a parable here about the great wedding banquet in which kings are invite, well, the kings invite a number of important guests to the wedding of his son, but who, when they turn down the king's invitation because they're too busy to attend, we see in John's vision, the people in Jesus' parish refuse to come to the wedding, those who would rather serve the beast and worship his image, of those who fail to flee from the harlot's arms. But both times you see in Matthew and Luke, the king's judgment falls on all of those who reject his gracious invitation. And since his invited guest, Israel, will not come, we read what it says here. He said to his servants, the wedding banquet is ready, but those I invited did not deserve to come. Go to the streets and the corners and invite all to the banquet, any that you find. So his servants went into the streets and gathered all the people they could find, both good and bad. And the wedding hall was filled with guests. Jesus goes on to speak how the king provided his guests with their appropriate wedding garments. And anyone who attempt to crash the wedding without the right clothing, they were destroyed. John speaks of the blessing of just receiving the invitation. An invitation that has come from God himself to attend the wedding of his son. But this invitation is not that of a guest. This invitation is for us as a bride. Look at look at verse 10 of chapter 19. Then I fell down at his feet to worship him. But he said to me, you must not do that. I am a fellow servant with you and your brothers who hold to the testimony of Jesus. Worship God, for the testimony of Jesus is the spirit of prophecy. You know, I've thought about this many times. The image or the actual presence of or a vision of an angel must be overwhelming, because throughout the New Testament, whenever someone has an encounter with an angel, two things happen. The first thing the angel has to tell them is, don't be afraid. The second thing is they immediately fall down prostrate in front of it. And each time, what does the angel say? Don't worship me. Worship God. So we see a similar thing happening here. John is moved by what he has seen, and he instinctively seeks to worship the angel that has brought such glorious news. But the angel will not accept this worship. And you also see in the New Testament, when they fell down before Jesus, he accepts the worship, which again shows that he is God, because only God should be worshiped. And the angel speaks to him that blessed are those who hold to the testimony of Jesus in the face of persecution, in the face of great seduction, and because they have persevered, and because they have been preserved by an almighty God, now they have an invitation to the marriage supper of Christ and the Lamb, of Christ the Lamb, really. We see here that Jesus Christ alone is the Lord. All of us who trust in Jesus Christ through faith alone have received an invitation to this marriage supper of Christ the Lamb. We will all revel in the true beauty of our wedding garments, the fine linen, the perfect righteousness of Christ. We don't have any perfect righteousness. All the righteousness that we have is given to us because of Christ's righteousness. We see Christ in his beauty. And because we have believed in Jesus Christ, we attend this glorious feast. We see that death will be no more. We recognize that everything that we have held to be purposeful and true and significant in our lives, now all of that is illuminated like never before, because again, we are amazed that God led us to the right choice, that he led us to his son, Jesus Christ, and that we have been blessed from the foundations of the earth, in which he chose us in Christ Jesus, because of the incredible love that he had for us. Not that we bring anything to the table. We don't even bring the glory we should to such a wonderful God. But because we serve such a loving and caring God that from the beginning made a decision to show his volitional love toward us. You know, real love is going to always be volitional. And real love is going to always speak more about the person who's being loved than it'll speak more about the person who's loving than the person who's being loved. Because volitional love says that I see your faults and I see your benefits. And once I add those up, I still love you totally. It's the love that we have for our children. It's the love that we have for our wives. The love our wives have for us. They know our good deeds. They know our shortcomings. But at the end of it all, they have decided to love us. And our God has decided to love us despite of ourselves and to cleanse us through his word so that he might make us blameless and without blemish and present us to himself. And, you know, amen. I agree that God loves us just as we are, but he loves us too much to leave us that way.
Amen. Amen. Wow. Well said, Andy. Especially as we're laying foundation for what's to come later in this chapter and for next chapter and so forth. So if I understood you correctly, you were saying the battle that was going on before this feast, right? The scene is the earth, perhaps even symbolic of all struggles, all times throughout, from the first incarnation to the second. Did I get that right? And then the scene shifts to heaven in the end game, the Feast of the Lamb and so forth. Is there any sense in which the battles that we were talking about, is there any sense in which the scene was also in heaven? That is, you know, one of the passages comes to mind is Ephesians 6, you know, it says we're not struggling against flesh and blood, but against powers and principalities in the heavenly realms. Talk about that for just a moment. And then we want to ask our infamous question Friday at Clay Terrace. How does this apply? Right. But first, did I get any of that right, Andy?
Yeah, definitely. The first part of that, I missed the last part of the question, whether or not these battles are taking place in heaven.
Yeah. Is there any sense in which the battles we're reading about here in Revelation, are those at all spiritualized or are they happening elsewhere other than just these few people at the very, very, you know, end slice of time?
Well, if I understand you, the battles are going on from John's time to our time until the end of our time. Now, whether we're saying those battles are taking place in heaven, the rejoicing is coming from heaven to see God's consummation here on earth as he defeats the harlot. But I don't see any, even in Ephesians when he's talking about battles in heavenly realms, I think sometimes you have to go back and to your understanding of how the first, second, third heaven, you know, how you see the heavens. Because the heavens, again, there's an ultimate heaven where there's only peace. And then there's the heavenlies, you know, that's right above our atmosphere where, you know, you see back in Daniel where he's praying and he says that the Lord heard your prayer at its inception, but Michael, the archangel, had to fight with Satan as he was coming down to deal with that. But don't despair, he heard it from the moment that you made it. But so there is a spiritual battle that takes place in the heavenlies. But as far as heaven, I see heaven as being a place of serenity.
Okay, so yeah, exactly that battle you talked about where Michael is weighing in, did that all occur? And I've heard it said that that occurred up to the cross. And once we got to the cross on the timeline, that battle was done.
Right.
So this battle we're reading about in Revelation is simply the portion on the earth as you see it. And then I may give Jim Wright a second to see what his thoughts are on that too. Did I get that right, Andy?
Yes. But I'll give you an example. Now I want to hear what Jim has to say here too. But I want to give you an example of how something can be consummated, absolutely done, but we as Christians don't recognize it or refuse to recognize it. Okay? I'm going to look at Ephesians, look at chapter 2, look at verses 10 through 13, okay? I'm going to read it real quickly. Make it verses 11 through 13. Ephesians chapter 2, verses 11 through 13. Therefore, remember that at one time you Gentiles in the flesh, called the uncircumcision by what is called the circumcision, which is made in the flesh by hands. Remember that you were at that time separated from Christ, alienated from the commonwealth of Israel, and strangers to the covenants of promise, having no hope and without God in the world. But now, in Christ Jesus, you who were once far off have been brought near by the blood of Christ. You know, for over 25 years, I've been working feverishly in racial reconciliation. And the question I'm challenged with all the time is, how can we have racial reconciliation when we've never been reconciled? Well, that's because we've never accepted the reconciliation that happened through Jesus Christ's sacrifice on the cross. We are reconciled. He made the two one. We've been reconciled by the blood of Christ. That's a done deal. Now, the problem is we don't believe the memo. And we don't believe the power of the gospel. So we still deal with one another as if this never happened. Even if you go to 14, he says clearly, for he himself is our peace, who has made both one and has broken down in his flesh the dividing wall of hostility. It's a done deal. And just like at the, you know, we see at the end of Revelations, Jesus wins. So it doesn't depend on whether we accept it. It's still absolutely true. But as Christians, those who follow Christ, we must accept Christ at his word and believe that he's done everything that he said he's done or he's ever promised to do. Jim, go ahead, close us out. Clean up my mess.
Oh, I don't know. You've had a lot of great stuff to say. So, I mean, clearly I view this as a literal battle that's going to happen on the earth at Armageddon. You know, again, I'm going to base that on a lot of Old Testament passages, especially Zechariah 12 and 14. And Isaiah and other passages like that. I believe it's going to be the culmination of God's wrath and judgment on the earth. So I don't spiritualize it. There is a spiritual battle going on in the heavenlies right now, but that's two different things. I don't think you can conflate the two of them together. So to me, this is just the final culmination of Old Testament prophecy with Israel and Christ coming back to judge. That's all I have to say right now.
Well, you're going to see that Jim and I come closer together from 20 to the end here, because I get real literal, when he talks about the battle and he talks about the fact that the ravens eat the flesh of those who have been destroyed. Mm-hmm. Because, I mean, you had to think about it after the flood. Can you imagine after the waters subsided after the flood, how many corpses there were on the earth, and how did they get away? How did they go away? The Lord did the same thing. He sent the ravens in there to knock it out. His own cleanup crew. So it's just amazing. I mean, all of this has been amazing. But once you go from next week to the end, it's just like, oh my goodness.
Yeah. So David's probably not familiar, but David will is like to move to an application stage of going, okay, it's Friday at Clay Terrace. What do I do with this? That we just talked about it, this great battle that's going to happen, not in my time, very likely, but in some future small time slice at the very, very end. But certainly the wedding feast, I get a lot more out of that passage, I guess. And as Andy said, you know, this is through the testimony of the saints and the worship of God. So anybody, how do we apply this? What do I do today differently than before I read this?
I think the application is don't be afraid.
Amen.
I mean, the king is on the throne. He's coming back and we don't need to worry about it. Our future is secure.
Amen.
So why live in fear?
I mean, just like the prayer request you had earlier about the Equality Act, I will be surprised that it doesn't pass, because it seems it has to pass that we might be totally convicted in our sexual immorality of the harlot. It almost has to come to pass.
Yeah.
Because it has to show that this world, this great Babylon, is so corrupt that it brings this world down on its own head. I'm not threatening it, fearing it all, because it's gonna pass probably. But this world's gonna pass.
Well, and in the meantime, we shine as stars in the universe some way or another. So I guess that's my application is today, go shine. Somewhere or another, go shine, go shine. Hey, who will close us in prayer? Oh, I saw Neil's hand go up. Okay, Neil, if you'd close us in prayer. God, we're thankful. We're thankful that you've given this to us in writing. What is our destiny? And Father, sure, we may or may not understand all the details of exactly what's going to come to pass. And yet, I'm certain that people that are present in those times will recognize it and again say, yeah, you told us that all along. You've given us promises, and your promises are always sure. So, yes, Father, we look forward to this great day that we'll be at the wedding feast with you because of your righteousness. Thank you for the fine linen that you cover us with. So, Father, be with us today as we hopefully shine amongst our neighbors in deed and in word. And, Father, help our memories always that we remember to give you the praise. In the name of Jesus, amen.
Amen. God bless.